thanks to TJ and the organizers of this event in this very, very beautiful place. So, yes, a lot of synthesis has been going on in Canada, as I started to say earlier, and in my report to the nations, I was remiss in sort of discussing French Canada, which is incredibly active. But I think Jacques Vivienne took care of that in a way, and Melissa's going to talk about her work, which will bracket the other coast. So what we've seen recently is an influx of new artists working in holography. If you go on the Rabbit Hole site, you'll see a group of people making holograms, and if you're a holographer, you won't recognize many of them. Jacques Vivienne you'll recognize, but many of them come from a background of digital graphics. And they're perhaps maybe not people who have exhibited in the art world, in galleries, who haven't spent 30 years slugging it out in the trenches with analog holography. And so there's this weird kind of resentment about that amongst certain people I've spoken to. And I think it's just because we haven't seen the analog holographers really come to the fore yet and get involved in digital holography, which is something I think will happen as a matter of course. So, yeah, we're starting to see the creation of holographic input changing. How you make holograms is changing. And I reported on this in Vienna some 9 years ago. Maybe a little optimistic, but now we see it actually taking place. So I hate people who read their PowerPoint presentations, so I'll just chatter on while you catch up. But direct write holography has many advantages. It's full color, it's natural color, so we're looking at flesh tones that are totally believable and look photographic, look like their computer graphic counterpart, which I think is amazing and important. They have varying angles of view, but because it's a single step process, they typically have a wider angle of view than the two-step process. And we've seen holograms as big as that projection screen from Rabbit Holes and Zebra, fantastic huge murals. It's an automated process, so for the most part, they've got a pretty good yield, and that makes the process reliable, repeatable, and way, way cheap. So you can go online now with Rabbit Holes, and they have this kind of get acquainted offer. Starving artist one run through, as we used to call it. So you submit your project, and I think for about $500 you can make your first full color digital hologram. That's virtually unheard of. And you know, we know why Holographics North has to charge what they charge for a large full color hologram. These guys spent $24 million in 10 years developing the thing, and it works very well. Just a little bit about the technology, because I think many people don't understand how it's different. And one of the ways it's different is that it's this particular process, and the holograms you'll see at the gallery are HPO. It means horizontal parallax only. And so commonly we'll make a computer model and create, for a large hologram like the ones you'll see next door, make 1280 frames. A virtual camera swings around over a certain geometry, records 1280 frames. And those frames then get synthesized into the hologram that you see next door. But to do that, you have to appreciate that there are some what's called pixel swapping going on. So everything that's known about the eye, the right eye of this Mietz Meyer hologram, has to be swapped into a set of Hogels which relate to the right eye. And then all of the data about the nose from the 1280 frames gets pixel swapped into a set of holes around the nose and so on. I've got an animation here which shows what the spatial light modulator sees when you actually print the hologram. Any windows open, perhaps? Okay, I'm just going to close these guys and start over. So this is a little bit misleading. And if this was tomorrow, I'd have my pocket laser with me. Yep. No, we're good, thanks. I think you can see that. The printer at Rabbit Holes prints from top to bottom. So imagine that what's seen on the spatial light modulator here is what's being printed in a vertical row from the sort of Rubik's Cube graphic that we're looking at. And you'll see that the image on the spatial light modulator in this scan from top to bottom then bears no resemblance at all to the actual graphic that's being printed. So some remaining barriers in the direct write process, like many people would know that it's a one-off. If you want 200 posters, just set the printer going and the processor going. And there's very, very serious issues around contact copying. The techniques that we thought about take as long as the printer. So yeah, you're not tying up the printer. The printer could be doing something else, but there's an argument for just bringing online additional printers. The computational issues, and particularly in our conversations about full parallax holograms, are monumental, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Illumination issues. So when you have that hologram, which is referenced orthogonally to the plane of the hologram, and Zebra Imaging knows something about this too, you're trying to get those rays parallel, and so the light source, the distance the light source has to be away from the hologram is huge, in order to play that thing back with a distortion. And then some other issues we'll talk about are who can make holograms and what can make holograms of with this new process. Getting back to the rendering issue, this is the B1 size from Rabbit Holes, and it's a meter by 70 centimeters. And at 1.6 millimeters for the Hogel size, you're looking at nearly 500,000 holographic pixels or Hogels in a single image. Now, if each of those Hogels is the same vertically, then that's not such a difficult task. If you have to compute those things one by one, it compares with three feature-length Pixar animated films. You're rendering out three motion picture films, and that's one hologram. All right, so one of the things that our group's been involved with, initially making a place for our students in digital holography, we developed this thing called the Light Valve Printer, so my students can make large full-color holograms for the same price they can make a pulse hologram or a continuous wave hologram. And it's a white light transmission process. We all know what the limitations of that are, but it's a thing that allows us to do rapid prototyping and so on. So next steps for opening up who can make holograms and what you make holograms of are the creation of a holographic scanner with turnkey and advanced user functions. So we'll be showing you a little videotape demonstration of that and how it works. Develop geometrically correct recording and interpolation software. So one of the big problems if you're recording human subjects or subjects in natural light or studio light, is that if you're recording at 24 frames a second, you get like 10 seconds of video. Well, that's 240 frames, and you need 1280 frames. So you need to have some means of interpolating those images. We're using something called optical flow technology, which has a great deal of promise, but it still has difficulty sorting out the background and foreground, for example. You need to provide metadata. So Martin Richardson's lovely holograms that are almost always a human form combined with some digital element, that's pretty much what people want to do. And so you need this recording device, a scanning device, to be able to record metadata. And that's details like the subject to camera distance and the focal length of the lens and the shutter speed and all that stuff that will assist you in compositing in 3D, because it only really works if those two things look like they grew there together, right? So you have to take the real world image, and I'll show you an example of what not to do in a minute, and put it together with the 3D elements, and that has to all work together properly. So metadata is the thing that's going to help doing that. The other thing we're doing is providing facilities, and again, this is the Lightbulb printer for fast prototyping, because way too much time and money is spent on making expensive digital holograms when the pre-visualization process for that is really just not there yet. You can look at the computer graphic, but you have to make one to see one. So why not make a hologram that's maybe 10% less bright or has a less of an angle of view or something like that, a fast prototype. Study that and go back and make a better thing. Produce templates, project files, and all popular 3D animation software. So you get a disk, and it's got the 3D Studio Max, and it's got a project file all set up, and it says place subject here. So the virtual camera is all programmed, everything's set up, and there's something called MaxScript, and all you have to do is push a button and preview that thing, and then render it, FTP those files to the service bureau, and you're away. And then beyond that is a thing called a plugin, where you go to the Rabbit Hole site or the Zebra site, and you download a plugin for Softimage, Maya, whatever your favorite 3D animation software is, and you go ahead and create that thing, and then you go file print hologram. And it comes up and says, you've got illegal values here, or your image is too big, it's going to get cropped, or something like that. So these are all ways in which we hope to make accessible digital holography. Now, I've credited Stephen Smith with this photograph, and how's that possible, really? But this is one of my favorite photographs when we talk about what it is we undertook to do. We started this research over a year ago, and here's Stephen Smith with Nikon film cameras, all tweaked just to the right POV, and then Stephen's efforts, of course, really strip what we did, because Stephen is all prepared to do the matrix hologram, where you leap up in the air and all 36 of these things fire, and you've got this look around view that's frozen, whereas our scanners, you see how it plays out over time. So both things, I guess, are advantageous. All right, so with any luck, we should be able to bring up this animation. So here we're using a thing called the Red Camera, which is supposed to be the be-all and end-all for digital movie making. It's a 4K resolution camera. It's also incredibly inexpensive next to a Sony HD camera, which can cost $80,000. This one starts at about $18,000, and then you buy a lens and a handle and a battery and whatever. But this is the Rail device then in action, and so it both translates and rotates, which means that we can use a targeted geometry, and that has certain advantages, works with certain printers, and we can use a direct camera, just a simple translation. So here are some projects that we're undertaking. I'm talking a bit about the holographic book project, because we like people from here who have a bit of a leg up on holography and the aesthetics of holography to contribute to this project. And a couple of projects that I'm working on related to the rail. So this is author and activist Margaret Atwood, who agreed to be part of our prototype hologram with the rail, and she's going to be visualized in a digital rainforest, a 3D digital rainforest, not this one, this is just a fast prototype, And then it's going to be a tropical bird that lands on her outstretched hands. And so, again, this is a challenge for us to do that, to make sure that the recording geometry is correct with this device, and then to place that in this 3D tropical forest, which will actually be growing up in real time. So at the next symposium, you'll see that one, I hope. So the I lost my father this past year, who was nearly 90 years old, and a fabulous guy, and I spent some time with him before he died, and I couldn't help noticing, and not in a derogatory way, but how incredibly similar we are when we leave this world to when we started. And there's this thing that's written in the textbooks, and it doesn't matter if you know about it, you're not in any way immune to it. You experience your own mortality becomes an issue when your father dies. So I started looking around and found a company in Toronto, oddly enough, that does has software, forensic science software, that ages people. So this is software that they sell around the world to people who want to make an image of a missing girl who was lost at 4 years old. What would she look like at 14? So in my project, I'm going to take very, very young children and age them to 80 years old. And as a prototype, I'm using Ekaterina, one of our interns here, who is aged here to 45. And we didn't do hair color, which is an option. We made her gray, and then again to 75. And the software has some little tabs, which are lifestyle choices. Hideous things happen when you click on the one pack a day tab or the two pack a day tab. And your diet and all that stuff plays into how you'll look in the software. And so Kat was quite offended at the end result because she volunteered for this process. And I said, well, Kat, it's really just happening to you virtually. It's happening to me in reality. So, right, and so we have this new course in 3D visualization and holography. I don't know how to spell it, but again, the gist here is to place this all in the realm of 3D visualization. So you're going to take a bunch of physics students whose criteria for getting educated is that you tell us a bunch of stuff, and at the end of the term, we repeat it back to you, and you give us a good mark. And now we're saying to them, you got to make an art project, and we're going to apply this really esoteric criteria to giving you a mark. And they're like, well. And then the art students are having to learn some physics and some serious challenges understanding what it is they're doing. And so the course is a pilot course. It's now a permanent course, and really, really high marks from the participants. Somewhere here is a first project by a student. So these are our second year university students, and this is a collaboration between a physics student and an art student. This is a student who had some altercation with drug abuse at some point. Does anyone know why PowerPoint doesn't play QuickTime files? We're going to have a look at a hologram by Meets Meyer, who's a guy who writes books on how to use Maya software, and he has special effects and so on. But there's a hologram in the exhibition, yet unlabeled, from Meets' work. And he's one of these new artists that I was telling you about. Oh, I get it. 3D printer. I've got some stuff for that. And he makes these incredibly detailed works in incredibly short order. Well, the assumption again is that many of you have already devoted many, many years of your life learning how to make analog holograms, and maybe you don't want to sit down and spend 4 years learning 3D animation. And so we're going to provide some alternatives in terms of being able to scan real-world imagery. Well, I didn't bring Ron English's work, but he's this bad boy painter, performance artist, songwriter, wacko, who's making holograms with rabbit holes. And they're, the interesting thing is that they're video and they're interactive, so you get to watch him, you know, him and his crew go out overnight and transform a Honda billboard into this artwork. And he says, you know, 3 weeks will go by before anyone notices. And so these holograms are video documentations of his performance art. Very good. Well, thanks again to all those people who brought me here, and here's some contact information. The holographic book, we're going to take six projects that, you know, it's like Sesame Street, that belong together. That's the criteria. And we're going to make a book, and we're going to sell it to educational institutions and collectors and people who are interested. We're going to turn around and create a new book. So if you make a submission to the holographicbookproject.ca and you don't get accepted in the first small book, we're going to keep your work on file for the next one. Thanks very much.